Good morning. I was going to say you are almost welcome, but then if I say it too quickly, it sounds as if you're not quite welcome. You won't be almost welcome, so I won't. Feels very odd being the person welcoming today when I'm the newest member of the congregation, but there you go, it's my job. Before we start the service, can I just invite you to pause for a moment, just to open your hearts to the presence of Christ, who promises that when we gather in his name, he is with us. And even in difficult days, as many of us are facing at the moment, every single one of us has something to give thanks for. So just in the silence of our hearts, let's just give thanks today, this morning, to God for some good thing that we want to rejoice in. And every single one of us has things that are heavy on our hearts as well. So again, God knows our worries, our concerns, the people and the situations that we are praying for. Let's again just pause in silence and lift them before God, who knows us and loves us more than we will ever understand. Come, Holy Spirit, and move among us this morning. Fill this church, that the light of Christ may shine in us and through us to the glory of your name. I'll do the notices. I've been asked to say that there's on the coffee table there's an extra basket for cash donations for the Disasters Emergency Committee collection for Turkey and Syria, and it'll be there for the next two Sundays as well. I think all of the rest of the notices are in the service, are in the notice sheet. Could I just say a big thank you to everyone who was involved on Monday evening? Lovely occasion, and it was great to welcome Bishop Sophie here to license myself, Iain, Jane and Christine, and it's great to be here this morning. So we're going to stand, if you're able to stand, we're going to stand and sing our first hymn this morning, Praise the Lord, ye heavens adore him. And I'll turn off the microphone before I start singing.
Praise him, all ye stars of light.
Blessed are you, Lord, our God, King of the universe.
To you be glory and praise forever.
From the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is proclaimed in all the world.
To you be glory and praise forever.
We join together in the opening prayer. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'd like to sit or kneel for our time of confession. And I always say confession is not about burdening ourselves with guilt, making ourselves feel ashamed or guilty. It is about giving to God principally our failure to love. Our failure to love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength. And our failure to love our neighbour, whoever that neighbour might be, as we love ourselves. And when we give our failure to love to God, in Christ he deals with it for us. And we are left cleansed and ready to live to his glory for another week. So God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. And so we confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments, to live in love and peace with all people. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you, against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who forgives all who truly turn to him, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And we collect the special prayer for today. Almighty God, give us reverence for all creation, and respect for every person, that we may mirror your likeness in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we remain seated for our first reading. Do I read the start?
Yeah, I'll read.
Oh, sorry. There you go.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, his love and good favour. Give thanks to the God our God, his love and good favour. Give thanks to the Lord of Lords, his love and good favour. To him who alone does good for us, his love and good favour. Who by his understanding meets the heavens, his love and good favour. Who spread out the earth upon the waters, his love and good favour. Who meet the fruit life, his love and good favour. The sun to give in the day, his love and good favour. The moon and stars to give in the night, his love and good favour. He remembered us in our estate, his love and good favour, and freed us from our enemies, his love and good favour. He gives food to every creature, his love and good favour. Give thanks to God of heaven, his love and good favour.
Thank you, Jonathan, and we're going to stand and sing again, and it's a hymn that reflects that reading from the psalm. Give thanks to the Lord our God and King, his love endures forever.
Give
remain standing for the Gospel reading.
The Gospel reading is taken from Matthew chapter 6. It uses the wording of the modern Message Bible. Hear the Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
If you decide for God, living a life of God worship, it follows that you don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtimes, or when the clothes in your closet are in fashion. There is far more to your life than the food you put in your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the birds, free and unfettered, not tied down to a job description, careless in the care of God, and you count far more to him than birds. Has anyone, by fussing in front of the mirror, ever got taller by so much as an inch? All this time and money wasted on fashion. Do you think it makes that much difference? Instead of looking at the fashions, walk out into the fields and look at the wildflowers. They never crimp or shock, but have you ever seen colour and design quite like it? The 10 best dressed men and women in the country look shabby alongside them. If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, most of which are never even seen, don't you think he'll attend to you, take pride in you, do his best for you? What I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax, to not be so preoccupied with getting, so you can respond to God's giving. People who don't know God and the way he works fuss over these things. But you know both God and how he works. Speak your life in God reality, God initiative, God provisions. Don't worry about missing out. You'll find all your everyday human concerns will be met. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now. And don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will help you deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Morning.
Morning.
So am I one of the best dressed men compared to a friend here? So one or two people I don't know in the congregation. My name is Iain Armstrong. I actually can stand here and I say I'm one of the four ministers in St. Mark's. I have a badge for it.
Hey,
there is a problem with that badge. I've got it somewhere really safe. Trying to find out where that real safe place is at the moment. But I know I took it home, so it's not here. So I do have the badge. So my first sermon on is a vocal minister. So don't worry about it, okay? Worry about it, it's not going to make it any better. It'll be as good as it gets. Anybody watch Happy Valley? Did you watch Happy Valley? Well, I don't know if you know, but Happy Valley finished, was it last weekend, wasn't it? They ended with five different endings, which they decided towards the end of last weekend which one they would do. Believe it or not, that's what the newspapers said, so that's true. Well, I've got two endings to this sermon, and it changed because I was at the Mother's Union on Tuesday. And some of the things we talked about, Wednesday, whenever it was, I was there. And so I might just say, I'm not quite sure where I'm going to finish on this one, so you just have to bear with me. But let us just pray. Dear Father, whatever I think I've prepared for you, I just ask that you take my words, become your words, that you teach each one of us something fresh, something new. You assure us, encourage us, and bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. So, it's just a really irritating thing, you know, when people tell you don't worry, which is basically what the reading from the Gospel was all about, do not worry. It's so much easier said and done, isn't it? And I'm sure, like myself, and I've been on the other end of this, that you've tried to reassure someone when they're worried about something, and you know that everything's going to be all right, you say to them, no need to worry. And you still worry. Okay? So what does the gospel tell us? What does Jesus tell us? Well, it's really easy. It's really easy. It's almost as if it's a dead easy choice. No need to worry, because it doesn't help. That's basically what the gospel says. Don't worry, it's not going to help. And Jesus addresses this explicitly at the beginning of that reading. He says, can any one of you add a moment of your life or span to by worrying about something? And it's one of those rhetorical questions, isn't it? It doesn't even need an answer. The obvious answer is no. You cannot add a single moment to your life by worrying. You cannot add a single minute to your life by worrying. Worry cannot help your children behave any better. Worry cannot increase your church attendance. It cannot improve my preaching. It cannot improve your karate, can it? You'll learn something about this guy's karate. He's got a peculiar hobby, which is really a bit disturbing for a man of the cloth, I must tell you. But what it cannot improve anything about us. But we do know this, don't we? And why does Jesus teach us this? Why do we have to understand it? Because worry can actually damage us. It damages us. Worry damages our relationships. Worry robs us of our joy. Worry robs us of our opportunities. Worry can affect each and every one of us. Worry affects others. Worry can affect our relationship with the living God. And we worry all the time. Worry only has negative effects. There is no positive in worry, in the world of worry. But let me point this out, it's absolutely crucial. There is a genuine place for concern. Concern and worry are not the same thing. Concern does this, it acknowledges that something needs careful thought. Worry is given to consuming trepidation. Concern gives way to planning. What does worry give way to? Fear. Just fear. Concern leads to healthy attention. Worry leads to unhealthy anxiety. Towards the end of that reading, Jesus concludes the passage by saying, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Each day has enough to occupy our minds. Why would you want to add to worry that we already have, concerns that we have? There is no advantage to worry or anxiety. It does not help. That's why Jesus taught us about it. Be concerned, but do not be consumed by worry. No need to worry because it doesn't help. And no need to worry. And why do we not need to worry? Here's the crux of the good news of the gospel. No need to worry because God knows what you need. God knows what Iain Armstrong needs. He also knows what Iain Armstrong wants, but he also knows, more helpfully, what Iain Armstrong needs. And he gives us those examples, doesn't he, from nature. The examples of the birds of the field. Little explanation needed? It's obvious, isn't it? Jesus was a masterful teacher, so we understand what he's saying right then. The birds do not worry about today, tomorrow, whatever, they don't. God's natural created order has provision built in it for feeding all his creatures. This world's in a mess, because man's made it a mess. Not because God is anything less than generous. God is a God of provision. He has provided it, and we are destroying the world we live in. Our culture is losing its value for human life, isn't it? But be rest assured that God has not lost it. His value for human life. We, just think about this truth. You are his prize. We are his people. Everything we need comes from him. James tells us later in the Gospel elsewhere, James 1:17, that every good thing, perfect, comes from him. Food, clothing, money, faith, love, grace, forgiveness, all come from our Creator God. It all comes from our Heavenly Father. Towards the end of that verse in James, Jesus challenges our faith on this. He says, you of little faith. Why are we so little in faith sometimes? Because we worry about the wrong things. We worry. And here's a challenge, and it's slightly something we talked about. I'm not going to go into huge details at the Mother's Union this Tuesday or Wednesday. Sorry, I still can't remember when I was there. And they presented the accounts for the Mother's Union. Okay? And one thing the Mother's Union do is give away a percentage of their income. It's not massive. It is life-changing to where it goes to. It's not massive. One of the challenges we have as a church this year, we always have a challenge, is what we do with our church finances, cost of living finances. It's hard for all of us. And I know the PCC and as a church, we're going to need to think about how we spend our money. What do we do? We need to be concerned. We need to be concerned. But we need not worry about it. Because God has given this church exactly what it needs to extend God's kingdom. We need the faith to believe that. Here's one of the challenges, as I was sort of talking to the Mother's Union about this, is that we as a church give quite a bit of our money away, quite rightly. That's a God-given command to do so. It's the tithe in some ways, and the tithe is more than just giving money, but it's the tithe. And we as a church give some of that money away. Do we, to make ends meet at the end of this year, cut back on that giving? Personally, I would say no. I think we should be concerned because the faith that I have is a God of provision. And that tithe doesn't mean give back to God in response to everything he's done for us. Give back what we've got left. The tithe says it's the first bit of you. That's what God wants. He only wants the first bit of you, not what is left. Because God is a God of provision. It is why we do not need to worry. We worry. Do you believe that you are God's prize? Because that is the truth. God created you because he wanted something fresh to love. You are his prize. He is not going to leave you and us without the very things that we need. If the focus of our life is only on things of this life, we have a faith problem. If we are concerned, metaphorically speaking and reality speaking, of our food provision, of our finances, of our fashions, if that's all we're concerned about, we will worry. But Jesus is concerned with our faith, because our faith is important. If we worry about the wrong things, our focus is messed up. So where should our faith be? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided. That's the final point. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided. Either Jesus is telling the truth, or he's lying. It's not, what does he mean by that? could he possibly mean? He says, all these things will be provided for you. Not for him, not for me, for you, for us together. We need to recalibrate and refocus our lives on what is important. Godless people, as we heard in that reading, are focused on earthly things exclusively. They don't know this, that faith is greater than food. They don't know that charity is greater than clothing. They don't know this. This is the crucial, the changing thing. They do not know that grace is greater than gain. We know, as God's people, that grace is greater than gain. They do not know this, that love is greater than luxury. They do not know this, that the blessing of God and God Himself far outweigh the needs of this world. They sadly are focused on the wrong things. Followers of God should be focused on God. The reason we in this place need to extend God's kingdom is there are far too many people that we know and we love who do not know that charity is greater than clothing, that love is greater than luxury, that grace is greater than gain. Amen.
Stand and affirm our faith and trust in God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in the words of the Creed. Say together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
We sit on kneel for our time of prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for His goodness. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we pray for your church. We pray that the light and the love of Christ may shine in your church, and through your church to the world that you made, the world that you love, and the world for which Christ died. We pray for those who feel excluded or rejected by the church. Help us to make our welcome as wide and as deep as Christ's welcome. Pray for those entrusted with leadership in your church. Pray today for Justin and Stephen, our archbishops, for Pete and Sophie, our bishops, for this church of St. Mark, its leaders and officers, for all who serve your kingdom in this place. Lord, we pray that we may be inspired by your gospel and filled with your spirit, and we reach out in love to your Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray for your world. Today, heavy on our hearts is the situation of the earthquake survivors in Turkey and Syria. We give thanks for the rescue, international rescue, which is beginning to build up momentum, and for the generosity of so many people in this land and others to help those victims. We pray for the people of Ukraine, pray not simply for peace but for justice for Ukraine. We continue to pray for the people of Iran and Afghanistan, especially for the women and girls of Iran and Afghanistan. We pray for this land, our parliament and local government, for all who lead us. We ask you to give us leaders of vision, wisdom and integrity to guide us in your ways. We pray for the deep divisions that have opened up in this land and pray for healing of those divisions. We give thanks for Charles, our King, and we pray for our royal family as they approach his coronation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we pray for the sick and the suffering, for those who are at home, in hospital, hospice or nursing home, for their families and their carers. We pray for those suffering from depression, stress, for those who despair. In a moment of silence, we hold in our hearts those known to us in need of prayer. We ask you to bring them to fullness of body, mind and spirit, in this world or in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the souls of the departed, holding in our hearts those people that we love but see no longer in this world. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace and rise in glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Father, we pray for ourselves. Lord, may we trust you each day of our lives, trusting you with our future and with our present. Living by your grace and loving as widely and as indiscriminately as you love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son. Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please stand for the peace. I'm not sure how you share peace, but I'll show you how to sign peace if you're not comfortable shaking hands. So you sign peace by going, peace be with you. So that's what I'm going to do anyway. So, Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body through his cross. We meet here in his name and we share his peace. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And say, peace be with you. And then share peace with those around you in whatever way you feel appropriate. I'm going to prepare the table for communion, and could I say this is a service of Holy Communion. Anyone who wishes to receive communion is welcome to do so. If you would like a blessing instead, if you tell them when you get to the altar rail, and we're going to give communion by intinction, John will be over the chalice, and I will take the wafer and give it to you when you come for communion. And if you're gluten-free, please let me know when you come to the altar rail. And as I'm preparing the table, we're going to sing, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God."
Jesus Christ is risen.
Jesus Christ will come again.
Jesus Christ will come again.
Father, as we bring this bread and wine, and remember his death and resurrection, send your Holy Spirit, that we who share these gifts may be fed by Christ's body and his blood. Pour your Spirit on us, that we may love one another. Work for the healing of the earth, and share the good news of Jesus as we wait for his coming in glory. For honour and praise belong to you, Father, with Jesus your Son and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
So we pray for the coming of God's kingdom and the words that Christ has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, which is blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Jesus died and rose again for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith, with thanksgiving. God, our prayer, divine your gift, the tree of life was set at the heart of the earthly paradise, and the bread of life at the heart of your church. May we who have been nourished at your table on earth be transformed by the glory of the Saviour's cross, and enjoy the delights of eternity through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we join together in the prayer after communion, which is on the screen. We say together, Almighty God, thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live in the world to your praise and glory. Amen. Right, I don't know if you normally do good news, but if anyone has any good news to share, is anyone about to have a birthday or just had a birthday? Statistically unlikely, so somebody's being shy. Okay, any good news anyone would like to share with church this morning? No good news. What a miserable bunch. Right. Have we got any good news? No, are you sure? Emily's coming back home, that's good news. No good news? Okay, any notices anyone would like to share with church? Well, that's good anyway, right. Please. So may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and in his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forever. Amen. And our final hymn is Father, Lord of all creation.
Oh. peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.